China has been addicted to stimulus. Does that sound familiar to you? Just about every country seems to be doing this now. It's absurd to think that monetary stimulus measures can actually fix any problems, and yet they're all doing so. Today, we're watching a change in rhetoric by China, and immediately stocks dropped as a result. Is that really a surprise? You came here for the truth, so let me unveil that for you. Today we're going to look at what has happened in China. I think it's important to follow this because as with all of the other central banks, I'm following what's happening in China and then I bring it to you. I found this information, thought it would be interesting, so let's dig in to the South China Morning Post. China leaders vow to reform, not to stimulate economy as trade deal with the US nears. So they suggest after this point, it's going to be going higher and you don't want to overshoot. You don't want to push too much because that creates the imbalances. So they're saying, we've already printed a hell of a lot of money. Let's just stop right here. Let's do some other reforms and then we'll be able to get the economy going even further as this whole trade deal comes to a close and then the stocks are going to go higher. Supposedly the economy is going to go in a much better direction. This is what they're saying. Surprisingly strong growth in the first quarter of 2019 brings shift in policy focus. Beijing's pledging to chime with Washington's demand for structural reform. I want to see how it all is really laid out when this document is officially signed. They put it on paper. We've already heard some things that should be a little bit hesitant for most people when you see that there are things that go out 6 years into the future from now. I think that is showing some serious weakness in this, but we have to see when it's all complete. All we know right now is these little tidbits of information. Most of it is coming from unconfirmed sources, so there's no way that we can really put a lot of weight on this, but it all depends on how it plays out. They're talking about the surprisingly strong first quarter growth. Many of the stock markets out there have performed extremely well throughout this period of time. We also had from the first quarter in 2019 in China, there was a lot of money being thrown in here. The stimulus has been excessive and we have seen the reserve requirement ratio that has dropped quite a bit in the banking system, obviously trying to get this going. So what was the result of this? As China put it out there, well, China stocks fall from a 13-month high on worries that Beijing may slow policy easing. Even the consideration that you will not be printing as much money as you were before actually causes stocks to fall. That's how dependent these markets are on the easy money, on the drip. Well, let's look further into this here. This is China's central bank balance sheet, which over the years has obviously expanded. I'm showing you a 10-year chart. Over the years, it has grown faster than basically everything, but I wanted you to know that their stimulus program doesn't work the same way as it does with the Federal Reserve. It's more complicated. They're not necessarily just printing money and that's their open market operations. There's a different way that it works, but I just wanted to give you an idea just to show you, yes, it has expanded greatly. Now, in the last few months, this data right here, I'm pulling this from Trading Economics, but the actual data apparently is from the People's Bank of China. So they're getting that data. I don't know how updated it is exactly, but it is recent. What they're showing here from February, that data there just gives us a little bit of insight, but what they've done in between now and then, I'm not too sure. I think they have been putting some more into it, but we'll see. As time goes on, I'll show you an updated chart. So further down in that SCMP article, China's senior leaders have congratulated themselves on saving the country's economy from a hard landing during the trade issues with the US and have decided to focus on structural reforms instead of stimulus to move the economy forward. And the real situation here is that why, if the economy is doing so well, why would you ever need to print money? You should be able to pull all that back. You should be able to increase interest rates up and you should be able to not necessarily be giving out loans to people who shouldn't have them. But of course, we're in a topsy-turvy world. Apparently, they concluded that market confidence has returned and economic performance was better than expected. All right, excellent. In the absolute controlled and manipulated statistics, they've determined it's better than expected. So congratulations to them. The focus will shift to reform and opening up, as well as restructure, according to the data from this meeting. I don't know exactly what that means at all. I'm sure we're going to get some information as the trade deal closes. Then we'll get something to do with this, and I will try to bring it to you. I'm not sure if there's any real side to this, but we'll see. In another departure from earlier meetings, the statement on Friday did not mention stabilizing employment, finance, trade, foreign investment, investment, and expectations, which suggested that China's emergency economic management focus on growth is largely over. Now, I don't necessarily think that's the case. I think they're putting this information out there. They want to perceive that strength. They want to make sure that the market knows, hey, everything is fine, and we don't need to do the stimulus anymore. And then secretly they're going to be doing it behind the scenes. But this is what we're being told right now, and so I'm bringing it to you. The stimulus will be weak and the reform will be strong. This is an analyst suggesting that, but I just wanted to show you this as well because this is what they're saying. This is what's being brought out there into the markets, so they will be trading accordingly. This was from earlier in May. China issues record new loans in the first quarter of 2019 as Beijing battles a slowing economy amid the trade issues. Chinese banks issued a record $865 billion of new loans in the first quarter of 2019. They went too far, if you ask me. What they did was they lowered their reserve requirement ratios, they relaxed all of their lending standards, and then they gave money out to people who probably won't be able to pay it back, at least a percentage of them. Then we'll have the defaults. Then we're gonna have some big issues here, but let's worry about that down the road, because as long as you save the economy now, we can worry about the rest later. In March, banks issued $251 billion in loans, the second highest, behind only March 2009. If you remember when that was the absolute low point of the S&P 500. And so here we are, hitting again another moment in time in the past, and it seems to reverberate as we see throughout this period here in 2018, as well as into 2019. We'll see how that goes. Although the U.S. Federal Reserve suspended the pace of interest rate increases, which gives China more room to continue a loose monetary stance, many Chinese economists now argue over if it is necessary amid the current economic improvement. And this was an article here talking about that, talking about what they were doing. Do they really need to create so much stimulus if supposedly everything is good? So this is what worries me considerably, not just in China, but anywhere around the world. If you are out there telling people things are good, but at the same time you create stimulus in the form of central bank easing, maybe you do a bailout program, maybe you are giving incentives for housing, for instance, you're basically signaling, and also interest rates, I should add, you're basically signaling the weakness. You're out there projecting through the media, through your own channels, that everything is good, but your actual underlying activities are not really showing the same thing. So I think that's hilarious whenever I see this type of information coming out. Everything is fine, we're just going to print some more money. Everything is fine. Well, it doesn't really fool those who are paying attention. Very quickly, I wanted to cover this out of Bloomberg. China and Japan made key progress on a program that will allow cross-listing of ETFs and make it easier for investors to buy shares in each other's nations. China is pressing ahead with plans to allow more foreign investors into its market, including those from its historical rival, Japan. So they are trying to connect, they are trying to expand, and of course, this is a lot of money, I'm telling you right now. If you look at this, taking off, investors pour into ETF tracking Chinese stocks ahead of the MSCI, adding more to the index. This just shows you two examples. Since the beginning of 19, rocketing higher, the blue line right here is showing the CSI 300 was down to 500 million and now it is over 2 billion. Just to give you an idea of the amount of money that has been flowing in here in such a short period of time. So we'll see what happens with the ETFs as they expand. Obviously, passive investments have become the new greatest thing. It's all good on the way in, it's a problem on the way out, but we're going to see that firsthand in the next recession. I think it's important to watch the ETFs and how many people people here are going to be rushing for the exits, as you see every time. The only difference is that in the previous recession, ETFs were so brand new, there was very little money in them. Today, they've become the newest, hottest thing. And so we're going to be in for one hell of a ride. That's all for this video. If you found it informative, please give me a thumbs up. When you give me a thumbs up, you are supporting this channel. So I do appreciate that very much. If you want the financial education you were not taught in school, these two books have everything that you need, all of that financial data, but explained very simply. I use diagrams and charts in my first book. The second book is extremely easy to read through. Actually, both of them are, and they basically get into all the details you need to know. If you read these two books, you basically got it all down, no problem, because they are explained so simply, and yet we're talking about complex subjects. Check them out at the link in the description. If you want the audiobook, that's available at themoneygps.com. Here is another video that's interconnected with it, talking about China. I think it's important to see what's happening there, so click on this video and I will see you there.